Have you ever lost a USB stick or laptop with valuable research? If so, how much work did you have to do to regain the lost data? And were you able to recover all of the data? If you look at a folder or a notebook with data from a project that ended 2 years ago, would you still be able to understand the data and make use of them? Have you ever read an exciting research publication and wondered if you could get access to the original data because it might be useful for your own work? Well, if you can relate to any of these scenarios, then you already understand the importance of good research data management. The amount of research data produced is growing rapidly. A cautious estimate is that the data output is almost doubling every second year, and according to the IT company IBM, 90% of the world's data has been created during the last 2 years. New technologies for accessing, transferring, and analyzing data give us exciting new opportunities to collaborate and advance research more rapidly, but only if our research data is of high quality, well described, well structured, properly stored, and made available to others. That is what research data management is about. But hold on a minute. Not all data can be made available for others by default. Some research data contain personal information, and some are subject to confidentiality agreements or copyright. Research data management is also about how you comply with regulations for such data and about how to make sure they are protected from unauthorized access, both when you store the data and if you want to share them with other researchers. If you follow good practices for research data management, you can strengthen your visibility and recognition as a researcher and contribute to making research in general more reliable and faster.
Research data management is important because it allows you to be transparent about how you have built your data sets and what you have done to them. That's important because it allows you to have collaborators that can trust what you're doing. It also allows those collaborators to reuse your data. They can see how you have created the data sets and how you have processed the data sets. And very importantly, it allows you to come back to your data process further down the line in a research project and remember how you created certain subsets, filterings, and so forth. So it allows you to find your way around your own data process in a project.
Research data management is important for me as a researcher because I don't like to start from scratch every time. So typically I start by looking at what other people have found out before me. And if I can find a data set, I can build upon that. So instead of having a 1 year time span, maybe I have a 10 year span instead.
I think good research data management can help prevent something we call sloppy science. So that's not necessarily research misconduct, but those are, let's call them honest mistakes that were made. So if you have a good structure in which you keep and manage your data, it's much easier to stop yourself from making mistakes that other people might think are research misconduct.
The benefits of data management are many, and doing the kind of research we do, generating large amounts of data from mass spectrometry analysis, we couldn't do without doing very careful data management.
Many actors involved in research are beginning to require that researchers document their data management practices and share data whenever possible. This goes for funding agencies, publishers, ethical committees, and even universities.
Research is becoming more and more data-driven, and our researchers are dealing with more and more complex data. We see these data as an important outcome of the research, and it's very important that these data also are well organized and available for others to reuse. This requires that data are well structured and carefully planned for. Good research is based on honesty, credibility, and transparency. Providing high quality data and applying best practices for data management helps to support these principles.
An increasing number of scientific publishers require that research data underlying publications should be made available for all readers. Some publishers only require access to data for the reviewers. Journals like Nature, Science, and PLOS require access to data for readers as a condition for publication. the publisher Wiley encourages authors to share their research data, but each of Wiley's journals has its own individual data policy. The requirements are often stated in the instructions for authors or in the journal's guidelines for research integrity. But what is research data? Research data can have many forms, and the definition varies greatly across disciplines. The Danish Code of Conduct for Research Integrity gives the following definition. Primary material is any material that forms the basis of the research. Data are detailed records of the primary materials that comprise the basis for the analysis that generates the results. Let's have a look at some examples of research data.
I am a PhD in systems and control, and the aim of my research is to create, design, and implement intelligence for robot swarms. Robot swarms are teams of individual robots that they go beyond the capability of individual robots. And those are very useful for example, research and rescue, environmental monitoring, or surveillance for very, very big areas. The data that we work with are flight records. We record inputs from different kinds of sensors, for example, perception, inertial sensors, position, etc. And the output, which is the behavior of the robot, how it's moving around, how it's behaving with respect to other robots, and those are recorded in flight logs.
So I'm a media scholar, and I look at media text and media actors, and more specifically on political communication often, because, you know, journalism is very often on politicians. And we look at what's going on in media texts, what's going on in the actors, we look at social media presence, and we look at patterns, and we try to say what's the implication for democracy. So this is an example of social media data crossed with a lot of other data. In this instance, we're looking at tweets from politicians and quotes in legacy media on this axis. What we see is here that most of these politicians down here, they're running with all the attention in legacy media and they get elected. What we see over here is that there's a lot of unknown politicians. They're trying to do a lot of tweeting. They're not getting elected. Up here, we have like the hybrid media politicians, the politicians that both are good in legacy media and getting quoted a lot, but also are tweeting a lot. And there aren't that many of them. That's a point in itself, that very few politicians actually master being on both platforms.
The data that I use in my research is mostly quantitative data. So information on how people feel or how they experienced their day or how depressed they feel today. So this is all very sensitive information that has to be kept in a secure location. The data that I collect is mostly collected on questionnaires on the internet, because that's a really quick and easy way to get a lot of information from people, which is then automatically stored in a secure database.
At the Copenhagen Center for Glycomics, we study the function of glycans, carbohydrates, sugar molecules in human health and disease. We extract proteins and glycoproteins from cells and animal tissues, and we analyze the proteins by mass spectrometry. This analysis generates large amounts of data, which ultimately gives us a large Excel file with exact protein and peptide sequences and localization of the glycosylation sites.
As a researcher, you normally deal with data along the different phases of your project, from the planning until you publish your results. The research data lifecycle is a simplified model that highlights the data management tasks throughout a research project. It also highlights that research data is a valuable resource in itself that should be shared, preserved, and reused for new research. In the planning phase, you need to consider how you will work with your data in a responsible way throughout your research project. Some of the questions you need to clarify could be, will you deal with personal data? Will there be possible ethical or legal issues regarding data collection? Do you need to set up an agreement with a data provider? What is the expected size of your data? How will you keep your data safe? A valuable tool for good data management is a data management plan. A DMP is a document where you describe which data you will collect or create and how you will handle them throughout the project, and even after the project is concluded. It is recommended, and sometimes even required by universities, to write a data management plan at the beginning of the project.
A data management plan is a good starting point for establishing common best practices within a research project. It helps to identify and resolve potential issues at an early stage and to avoid problems later. Data management planning should not be seen as an administrative tool, but rather as a good practice that all of our researchers should use in all of their work.
Many research funders also require data management plans, for example, European Commission, Innovation Fund Denmark, and Nordforsk.
When funding organizations ask for a data management plan, it helps me think the project through with respect to what data I will generate, how I will store it, and how I will share it with others.
When you collect or create research data, you should do it in a way so that others can understand your data and work with them. For example, by using standardized methods and common data formats, ensuring quality control of your data, and, very importantly, documenting all the steps you take to prepare and process your data. This is essential if someone should try to reproduce your results.
I am a part of a very big project, open source project. It's called Paparazzi for autopilot software and hardware. And we have some standards about how we collect data and how we post-process the data. So in fact, we share the same standard for logging. So others in every part of the world can actually check and verify that our algorithms are as they were written in paper.
Depending on your discipline, processing and analyzing your data includes data cleaning, validating, anonymizing, transcribing, translating, and many other things. For some of these processes, you will follow best practices in your field of research, while for others, you will have to comply with national and international legislation. This is, for example, the case if you work with personal or confidential data.
All the data that I have, as soon as I have it and I don't need to follow up on anyone, so that means I don't need to talk to the same patient again, gets anonymized immediately, because that's the safest way to make sure that nothing happens to the data should it, for whatever reason, leak or get to the wrong persons.
In practice, researchers spend a significant amount of their time collecting, processing, and analyzing data. In this phase, you must ensure that appropriate and secure storage solutions are in place. Where are you going to store your data? Are your data frequently and safely backed up? Who is responsible for storage, backup, and security of your data? What measures do you have in place for preventing unauthorized access?
We store the raw data on two hard drives and a university network drive. While working with the data, we share them through a folder that's protected by a password.
It is crucial that you check guidelines for data storage and data security at your university, and don't rely solely on personal laptops, USB sticks, or cloud services. Talk to your local IT support about recommended solutions. Once you're done processing and analyzing your data, you will start sharing your findings with the scientific community or the public. When researchers think about sharing research, they often think about sharing their results, for example, in scientific journals, conference proceedings, or books. But you can also publish your data along with relevant documentation in data journals or data repositories. This way, your data can be reused by others and properly understood, cited, and licensed.
It is important that we are sharing our data in our open source project, because we can only rely on each other if we know how your algorithm works, not only on the paper, but also experimentally. And this is done thanks to sharing the data.
The next step of the research data life cycle is to prepare your data and all relevant documentation for long-term preservation. The Danish Code of Conduct for Research Integrity requires research data to be retained for a minimum of 5 years from the date of publication, but be aware that other and stricter requirements may apply to your project. Also note that personal or confidential data, as defined by the European and Danish legislation, must be properly disposed of, anonymized, or migrated to the Danish National Archives for preservation after the project ends. The final step of the data lifecycle is enabling reuse of data for other research projects. Many research projects are finalized with the preservation of the data that was produced, and other projects might begin by reusing data in order to produce new research. If you follow best practices for research data management throughout your project, you will ensure that your data are optimized for reuse. Data repositories, either with a general coverage or within a specific discipline, can help you make your data discoverable for reuse by others. Or maybe you could find somebody else's data as a valuable input for your next project.
Once we publish our data, we upload the data behind the publication to a public available database where we can easily visualize the data that we generate. So, for example, here we have shown a protein called MLN1. We can zoom in to look at the protein sequence. And furthermore, we can add information on which tissues, which cell lines that we identify the data in. Sharing our data in this way actually generates a lot of new collaborations, and we get many contacts from the broad community asking for more details about our work.
This introductory module aimed to show you the relevance of data management in research and give you an understanding of what it entails for your projects, illustrated by the research data lifecycle. Regardless of your discipline, you should integrate best practices of data management as part of your research workflows. If you acquire the skills to manage your research data properly, you will be better prepared to comply with the increasing requirements, and it can make a difference in your career, either within or outside of academia. If you have questions about good data management practices, you can find help and guidance in the other modules of this course, and you're also welcome to contact the local research support at your university.